It's time once again for Fools on the Hill with Nicole Bell on the Nicole Sandler Show.
All righty then. This is the time of the week. Every Monday morning, we check in with Nicole Bell of Crooks and Liars. She and her team over there watch those Sunday talking head shows so we don't have to. Good morning, Nicole.
Good morning, Nicole. How you doing?
It's a Monday. Aside from that, I'm doing well. And you?
I'm doing really well. I'm actually really excited. Your show was on the TuneIn Radio app that I stream in my car, so I can actually listen to progressive radio when I'm taking my kids to school. So I actually heard you and Susie before I came on today.
Cool.
That's great, because that almost never happens. I have to listen to it a day late on the Stitcher
right.
app.
Ah, isn't that great? So through what station was it? Do you know?
I think it's for SoFlo Radio. But, you know, the TuneIn app they do, the TuneIn app, you can choose to listen to talk radio and progressive news, and there you were, right
Yay.
There with all the other progressive hosts.
Yay.
And I was so excited.
Oh, I love that. See, we're getting there. We're getting to the point where, and I should start doing that. I should bring, I could bring my phone in the car and plug it in and get it through the speakers and use TuneIn and find a show that I can listen to. So I don't, like this morning, I was talking about how everybody on, I listen via XM and like Morning Joe or CNN or whatever, they're all just, you know, oh, a morning Margaret Thatcher. Sorry. Enough. I don't need to hear that.
Yeah, no, don't get me wrong. I am grateful to Margaret Thatcher for breaking that ceiling.
Yeah.
I will say that. I disagreed with her politics in pretty much everything.
Right.
But you know what? She was a female head of state. So
right.
God bless that.
Exactly.
Because we need a whole lot more of that.
Yes, we do. But, you know, she also disproves my theory that if, you know, more women were in charge of nations, we'd have less war, we'd have more compassion. It just shows that not all women are you know, compassionate and motherly and, you know, caring souls.
Right. Well, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I think in order to get through that ceiling, she had to be much more like a man than than to really embrace the feminine side. And that's fine, because she's paved the way for future prime ministers in England, and she's paved the way for future female leaders all over the world.
That is true. That is true.
I'll give her that.
All right. I guess the one thing we can be thankful for is that her death didn't come before Sunday, because we would have been inundated with tributes to the great Margaret Thatcher. And yes, while she did, you know, break that glass ceiling, I'll give her that. Her policies were of austerity and privatization, and I don't think were a good thing. And so at least we were spared the Sunday shows all just, you know, eulogizing Margaret Thatcher.
Yeah, I don't know if that would, honestly, that might have been an improvement, because we could have pushed back on the whole notion of how great austerity is.
Right.
As it seemed now, it seemed like there was an awful lot of discussion on the Sunday shows that was really talking about how to make things worse for the country.
It seemed that way, right? And it starts with Jim Cramer. Jim Cramer is sort of an anomaly, isn't he? Because in some time, you know, there are times when he puts himself out there like he's, you know, like one of us, you know. But then we realize that he's just another shill like the rest of them.
Yeah, well, you know, they did a study of Jim Cramer's stock picks a couple of years ago, and followed them and tried to see how they did. And it turned out that he actually, if you invested money based on what Jim Cramer told you to do, you would have ended up losing money.
Yeah.
He did worse than the market average.
Lovely.
So that is one of the things that I don't really understand about how Jim Cramer continues to have his job. You know, it clearly competence, clearly, understanding of economics is not one of the things that they require you to have the headlining show on CNBC, the, you know, financial network of note for the country. And I find that puzzling.
Right.
You know, he was the one who was, I think it was it Sherson Lehman or Lehman Brothers? He was touting one of the companies that went belly up. Literally 2 weeks before they went belly up when the stock market, or when the crisis hit.
Okay, well, so here's what he said yesterday. We don't even need to preface this. This is Jim Cramer on Meet the Press yesterday. He's got the answer. What is it the answer to? All our ills, our unemployment problems, our
economic problems,
economic woes?
All of our ills.
Okay, here it is. Here we go.
People work in this country.
Oh, wait. And let me just say, the first couple of words were cut off. So I want to make sure what he said was, you want to put 60,000 people to work in this country. That's what got cut off there. Here we go. You want to put 60,000 people to work?
People work in this country in 4 weeks because these jobs are there. Keystone Pipeline. But this is a fossil fuel versus greens debate.
Yeah.
Why do I say that the pipeline does work? Because these pipelines have been the creators, the largest creators of jobs in the last 4 years. You may hate fossil fuel. You may think that it's ridiculous to be able to have it so that oil and gas are in charge of hiring in this country. But we've got tons of oil and gas in the wrong places. You put people to work on pipelines, $60,000 is the minimum that you pay a pipeline worker. You put people to work all over this country. That's what needs to happen.
That's what needs to happen. Really?
Well, I mean, it is hard to unpack just how much wrong there is with everything that he said.
Give it a shot, Nicole. Yeah.
Yeah. First and foremost, 60,000 jobs? No, not so much. The kindest estimate was 15,000 jobs, and those are 15,000 temporary jobs.
Temporary jobs, thank you.
That's right. Even if we hired all 15,000 people at the same time, mm-hmm. that is a statistical drop in the bucket of our unemployment rate.
Mm-hmm.
That is, it is 0.02%. That's all that the unemployment rate will raise. That's
right.
Nothing. There's no benefit to this. Now let's leave aside the environmental impact of it, because you know we're looking at what's happening in Arkansas and seeing what happens when you have tar sand pipelines going through neighborhoods.
Yes.
But leave aside that, there was a study done by Cornell that said that these pipelines will actually be job killers because this oil is not our oil. And it drives me crazy when I hear people talking about the Keystone Pipeline like somehow it's going to benefit directly us.
Right. It's going to bring our gas prices down. No.
Right.
It isn't.
Because what this is doing is taking tar sand oil from Canada and transporting it to the Gulf of Mexico where it can go out on the world market.
Exactly, to the highest bidder.
Right. No benefit. There is no direct benefit to the U.S. in any way, shape, or form, but we are going to endanger hundreds of thousands of Americans' lives by having a tar sand pipeline going through their neighborhoods.
Right.
And this is so toxic, so horrifying that the Canadians didn't even want it. That's why they want to go through the U.S.
Right. That's why they can't go west, because, first of all, the Native Americans, the I forget what they refer to themselves there, the indigenous peoples of Canada are saying, no way, you're not coming through our land. They don't want it, and all we need to do is look at, again, what's going on in Arkansas now, Mayflower, Arkansas, where this sludge is going through the streets. It's threatening their water supply, and this is not regular oil. It's heavy, dirty, crude shit that sinks to the bottom. So if it gets into the lake that feeds the water supply, you need to dredge the lake. You can't clean it up.
Right. And actually, Exxon got in trouble this weekend because chemicals that they were transporting to deal with this spill in Arkansas spilled in Louisiana. So we have now two toxic cleanup spots, thanks to Exxon's use. Let's just discount the job-killing aspect of it, the environmental aspect of it. Oil and gas, actually not the biggest employers in the last 4 years, which means that Jim Cramer pulled that fact completely out of his butt.
Yeah.
Guess what the largest employers have been in the U.S. for the last 10 years? Outsourcers. That's where all the jobs are.
Not surprised. I was gonna say like fast food and Walmart, because those are the most, the growing industries, the minimum wage jobs. that take advantage of the workers, that have to be subsidized by the taxpayers because they pay such low wages that people still qualify for public assistance.
Right. Well, if you look on Crooks and Liars, on the post we did with Jim Cramer, there's actually a list to the Forbes list of the biggest employers of the last 10 years. They're all temporary staffers and outsourcers.
Wow.
And so those are exactly what you're saying, Nicole. These are people who are taking advantage. They're hiring workers who don't get benefits,
mm-hmm.
who then have to rely on the public assistance for all of the everything else because they're not going to get it through their employer.
Yeah, exactly. So we wind up paying. So we're subsidizing these multi-billion-dollar multinational corporations so that they can keep paying these heinously low wages.
Mm-hmm.
It's disgusting. Absolutely disgusting. But, you know, for whatever reason, Greta Van Susteren, because she doesn't reach enough people on the fake news channel, goes on This Week, really, to explain... again, I'm still trying to figure out what she's explaining here. Why the Republicans won't compromise on, I guess, new taxes? It's beyond explanation, but here's her explanation.
The reason we have paralysis is because we don't have the money. And I think people want to take care of people. I don't think people want to take the safety net away from people who really need it, because Americans are really good, decent people. If we didn't have a revenue fight in terms of how much money we have, the condition of the economy, the condition of the national government, we wouldn't be having half these fights. And the two parties might be able to come together a little bit better. If we fundamentally got this economy up and roaring, we'd be fighting a little
bit
better.
We don't have the money is the only thing in that word salad that really stuck out to me. We, the wealthiest nation in the world, we don't have the money to do what?
Well, we don't have the money, apparently, to pay for social safety nets, which is why they obviously have to get cut, and that's why the Republicans are being so intransigent. The thing that never, ever seems to play into this equation is that there are two sides of this. You know, you can talk about how much the government spends. You can also talk about how much the government takes in. If the government is not taking in enough money to make good their commitment
mm-hmm.
to social safety insurance, and again, this is insurance. This is stuff we've paid into for years. If they can't make good on that commitment to the American citizens, then they need to bring in more revenue.
Hello. Exactly.
I don't understand.
I mean, it's pretty simple. Bring in more revenue. We've got plenty of money. We have more money in this, the United States of America, than any other nation on the planet. That includes Saudi Arabia. That includes Qatar. That includes United Arab Emirates. That includes all those oil nations with all their riches. That includes the Vatican with its treasures. We have more money than any other nation. Don't tell me we can't afford it. Don't say we can't take care of our people. Yes, we can. You just have to tax the people who are hoarding the money.
Right. And we have the lowest marginal tax rates that we have seen since the Gilded Age.
Right.
I mean, this is not a difficult equation, but the problem is that the conversation, especially on the Sunday shows, and, you know, this is what I don't want to, I'm not trying to sound mean to my mom, but this is where my mom gets her information,
mm-hmm.
is these shows. And she's not got time to go and look at all these things and look at white papers and to read other articles, and she doesn't have time for that. So she sits down, she watches Meet the Press, she watches This Week, and she thinks this is what's going on. And, I take her to be representative of most Americans.
Right, the ones who don't get their news from the, as Jim Carrey refers to it, Fox News. I mean, you know, she's trying to be responsible here and watch the so-called mainstream Sunday shows, which is supposed to give her real objective journalism.
Right, and instead what we have are a bunch of elites who are comfortably ensconced inside that Beltway bubble, do not understand what it's like for most people. I mean, my mom is, you know, my mom is on a limited income. She
mm-hmm.
is she's retired. She has a pension that's very small. She has Social Security, you know, and things are really hard for her. She made the decision to go and live with my sister to help pool their resources so that they could afford a house together.
Wow.
You know, this is the reality for so many Americans. And, my family's lucky. My family actually is, fairly well off. But even with that, what happens once you retire is tragic, And I cannot bear the thought of my mother having to make even more economizing just to have a halfway decent life. And that's why it just frustrates me so much to hear someone like Greta Van Susteren, who makes millions of dollars, who does not need to worry about where her next meal is coming from or whether or not she can afford to pick up prescriptions, to sit there and make these things and say, well, we have to cut. The Republicans understand we have no money. That's just wrong.
It's just wrong.
We have the money. We made these commitments to these people decades ago, and we have to fulfill our commitments.
Right, and you know what? And it's not only the current seniors. I mean, as I was talking with Susie, she and I are both in that next group. Hello, I'm depending on that 10, 12 years from now. I'm like, please let me, be around for another 11 and a half, 12 years, so I know that it'll be there for me.
Right. No, I agree. I mean, and I'm in the same boat as you. I mean, I'm a little bit younger, but still, because I have taken myself out of the workforce by choice to raise my kids,
right?
I'm not hireable.
Right.
Nobody is going to put me in a job when I haven't sat in an office for 16 years.
Right. Yeah, exactly. That's the thing. That's the problem. Exactly. It just sucks. And there's Greta Van Susteren saying, we don't have the money. Bullshit. Now, then, thank goodness Paul Krugman was there, because then she started into the other Fox, right-wing talking points. It's regulations that are killing small business. No, it isn't.
And you talk about the Main Street is that we're strangling small businesses. I mean, no one's paying much attention to these small businesses. The regulations that are strangling them, some are laughable and silly, but they have a profound impact on the job creators, those who are making jobs. They can't afford to hire people.
There's been tons of work on this, and what's holding small business back is not regulations. It's the fact that they don't have
sales. It's not
sales.
All. It's some of it.
There's no correlation. Looking across, which parts of the economy do small businesses complain about regulations, which don't they? There's no correlation between that and actual jobs.
Is there one exception to that, perhaps, on the health care, firms that are greater than 15 people?
That's enough. I mean, Paul Krugman sets her straight. No, it is not.
Right, but I want you to notice how whenever someone starts talking sense, whenever someone starts talking facts, all of a sudden it becomes this free-for-all,
yes,
and we don't get to hear the actual explanation. We don't get to hear, no, that's not. We just hear kind of a no, and then just a huge amount of talking. And then George Stephanopoulos, who, remember, used to be a Democratic operative, will then sort of concede Greta Van Susteren's point about because of health care.
Right.
So this is the framing that we get. You get Greta Van Susteren talking about how this is a job killer and how regulations are the problem. And nobody's ever been able to give me what regulations it is that happen to be the problem. Is it the OSHA regulations making a safe work environment? Is it the, labor regulations that say that you have to pay overtime if you force people to work over 40 hours a week?
Right.
Which regulation is it that is such a job killer?
Yeah, good question. Give us specifics, please. I would like to know.
Right. So she gets to say that uninterrupted. Paul Krugman tries to correct her, and then you don't hear anything else.
Exactly.
So this is why Americans think that this is a problem, because this is the way it's covered inside the Beltway bubble.
Yeah. Ugh. God, it sucks. Then, shocker. I know people are going to be shocked to hear this, but Lindsey Graham and John McCain were both on Sunday shows yesterday. I know it's a surprise, but gather your wits back about you and hear what Lindsey Graham had to say, of course, because the most pressing issue today is who's going to be running for president in 2016. Just listen to this.
We're going to talk after this break about presidential politics, waiting for Hillary Clinton. If she's the nominee, can Republicans beat her?
I think after 8 years of Barack Obama, if things don't change, the next Democrat running for president will be in trouble. She'll be a formidable candidate. I think her time as Secretary of State is mixed. Benghazi is yet to be told completely. But anybody who underestimates her on the Republican side would do so at her peril. But yes, she can be beat. Anybody can be beat in this country.
All right. So in you know, a 10-second answer, he invokes Benghazi twice.
Yep, because that's the most important thing facing the country right now. We just had 26 children and teachers killed 2 months ago in Newtown. Lindsey Graham doesn't want to do anything about that.
No.
But 4 people in a war zone in Libya is worth bringing up again and again and again, and worth bringing up in relationship to Hillary Clinton's run for president 4 years from now.
Right. Yeah, because Benghazi, you know. Yeah. Right. Oh, my God. But you know, of course, they did talk about more than just the 2016 presidential sweepstakes. This question that we've been talking about all morning of President Obama introducing his budget on Wednesday morning that will cut Social Security and Medicare, that is just is so unthinkable. Lindsey Graham, well, he weighed in on that.
Do you think that the president's framework that he announced, including chain CPI, a gradual way to cut Social Security benefits, is a good faith effort on his part? Do you think he can actually win some new revenues as a budget deal by doing it?
There are nuggets of his budget that I think are optimistic. It's overall a bad plan for the economy. But when you look at chain CPI and Medicare reductions, we're beginning to set the stage for the grand bargain. Change CPI, adjust, harmonize the retirement age of Medicare with Social Security, do some means testing for both programs, and in return, flatten the tax code, generate about $600 billion of revenue. And if you look at these changes over 30 years, it's $4 to $5 trillion in savings. So I'm looking for the biggest spending cut in American history by reforming entitlements, saving those entitlements, and the president's showing a little bit of leg here. This is
the what?
The president's showing a little bit of leg here.
Can I just say ew?
Ew.
The president's showing a little bit of leg here.
He is actually titillated by the notion that the president is willing to force grandma and grandpa to eat cat food. I just want to put it in perspective.
Now you
That's
got
exactly what he's titillated
yes,
by.
Yes, and you got to remember who he's talking to there. He's on Meet the Press with David.
You got to talk tough to seniors, don't you?
Gregory. All right, yep. They're getting what they want here, because these people who have paychecks in the, six figures and higher are saying...
You got to talk tough to seniors, don't you?
Yeah, and...
The president's showing a little bit of leg here.
Ew.
Yeah.
Yeah. And
it's just, that tells you how removed they are from most Americans' experiences.
Yes. unbelievable. Unbelievable. And then along those lines, and I mentioned this clip to Susie Madrick because I couldn't believe what I was hearing. And I actually was going to cut this, but people need to hear what these others are saying. These people, these media elite, I'll use that word, people who have very big paychecks, are talking about us people, we people who are hurting, you know, long-term unemployed, people who can't get a job, who are struggling to make ends meet, to feed their kids, to keep clothed and housed. Here's Tucker Carlson and talking to a guy named John Tammy.
During this past recession, the federal government paid almost $80 million in jobless benefits to the households that made more than $1 million a year. Is this proof that the system is broken, or should top earners be entitled to federal assistance if they lose their jobs? Joining us now is the editor of Real Clear Markets, John Tammy. John, thanks a lot for joining us.
Hey, good to be here.
How exactly did this happen? I think most people would be surprised to know that people making over $1 million are getting unemployment benefits.
Well, you know, on its face, it's unfortunate to hear about millionaires collecting unemployment benefits, but I would argue what would be even more bothersome would be
And I'm going to step in right here because I'm with them. If you are, you know, a millionaire, you have a C-level job and you get fired and you have plenty of money in the bank, should you collect unemployment benefits? Probably not, but you pay into it. You pay or your employers do, pay unemployment insurance. So I guess you're entitled to it. That's on the people. That's on the people themselves, whether or not they choose to file for that. And I say, if you don't need it, don't take it. But you know what? You know, that just goes to the selfishness of the right wing of this country, who, you know, get an accountant to you know, cook the books a little bit so that they don't have to pay any taxes.
Right. Well, and keep in mind, though, that this is also an anomaly. This is not something that happens that often.
Right.
You know, there, just like there are people who take advantage of the welfare system, they are the anomaly. They are the small, minute percentage of those who actually need and rely on these programs.
Right. They are the exception rather than the rule. But here's where you need to start listening. This is when the guest says, here's what would be worse than these, you know, millionaires collecting unemployment benefits, all right?
Millionaires collecting unemployment benefits, but I would argue what would be even more bothersome would be if millionaires were forced to pay into a system that only non-millionaires could collect from. Implicit here is the poor and middle class benefit or advantage from unemployment benefits, but really it deters their hiring. The, every dollar you take from the federal government makes it that much more difficult for private businesses to lure you back from the sidelines.
But isn't the current system basically an inducement to dependency? So everybody in America has government, who works, has government-backed unemployment insurance. Wouldn't it be better if just the poor had it and the rest of us could sort of take care of ourselves? Isn't that the way things are supposed to work?
Maybe, but I would say that would be cruel to the poor because it makes the poor the least likely to be hired during a downturn. The problem we have right now, and really businesses face it the most, is they have to pay into a system that makes it that much more expensive for them to lure workers back from the sidelines. It actually raises their labor costs. If you didn't have the federal government essentially paying people not to work, their labor demands would naturally fall to the level at which the markets would hire them again, and they would get back to work more quickly. I think it's anti-poor to say only you get a program that's going to make you unemployed for a longer time.
Interesting. So when you saw the numbers...
Okay, so let me just... I want to play more of this, but just to get clear, what he's saying is if you collect unemployment benefits, then that makes you less likely to get hired?
Right, because they'd have to pay you more to induce you to go back to work.
Oh, because you're already getting something for nothing, because you can live so comfortably on an unemployment benefit payment.
Yeah, I honestly don't know what unemployment rates are right now.
When I was
pregnant with my oldest child, I had to go on disability because I went into preterm labor, and I had to stop working.
Mm-hmm.
I thought $300 a month.
Yeah, I mean, and that's about what it is. I think it. Look, when I first moved back here to Florida the first time, I've been moving around. I had come off a very, very high paying job in California. Station was sold. Yeah, job lost. Because you know, it's based on your former pay. And because I had made $120,000 the year before, I was at the top level. And I think I got $500 a month.
Yeah,
I'm sorry.
I was going to say, I made about $80,000 that year. I got about $300 a month in disability.
Right.
I don't know who can live on $300 a month.
And nobody who's collecting unemployment, who's not, you know, trying to scam the government, and yeah, I'm sure there are those people who do that, who work an under-the-table job, but the majority, I'd say 99.9% of people who collect unemployment would much rather have a job and get a real paycheck. So okay, that's what he's trying to say. Again, when they make no sense like this, I have a hard time following them sometimes because it doesn't make any sense. But let's continue. So he's saying, all right, it would cost more to lure these people back to work because you'd actually have to pay them more than they'd get on unemployment. Okay.
Just the other day that showed that 500,000 people dropped out of the labor force in March. Do you think that unemployment had anything to do with that?
Oh, without question it does, because love or hate the number, if you're being paid money not to work, it's going to make it that much more expensive for businesses to hire you back into the labor force. So if you wanted to rid that, you'd get rid of unemployment benefits, and people would then have to accept the existing jobs that are available. Many of them maybe don't look attractive now, but I mean, I can think of my first job. It wasn't attractive, but it turned out to be a good one. Unemployment benefits are a deterrent to getting back into the labor force. So I think it'd be particularly cruel to say, if you're poor, you get paid to stay on the sidelines.
So unemployment benefits prolong unemployment. That's an irony story, no?
Almost by definition, they
do,
and it seems like the better solution would be for the federal government to essentially scrap the program, and when employees go to work, there would essentially be 401k-style programs that businesses would pay into and employees would pay into, so that if the unthinkable happens, you have a little cushion that you own for during the time that you're looking for a new job. A one-size-fits-all program.
All right, so basically, by their reasoning, you know, don't give food stamps to people who are hungry because, you know, the old, teach them to fish instead.
Right. Well, I mean, this is just one of those infuriating things. And let me point out one, that Tucker Carlson is one of the heirs to the Swanson frozen food fortune. His mother is a Swanson.
Oh, God.
So this is not a man who will ever, ever wonder where his next meal is coming from. He just needs to get into the freezer, and he's got him. And John Tammy is the editor of is an editor at Forbes magazine. So these are people who are actually discussing finances, making these kind of claims, which are absolutely patently absurd on their face and show a complete lack of knowledge of what reality is for most Americans. Because, again, I don't know anybody who can get by on $300 a month for unemployment or $500 a month in unemployment. And those people that are falling off the rolls, it's not because they're incented to not work. They're falling off the rolls because they are long-term unemployed, and we stop counting them.
Yeah, the whole argument is just crazy. It's just fucking nuts.
Right, and they're off the rolls because they can, I mean, again, I have been looking for work for years. I am no longer considered one of the unemployed because it's been years.
Well, I'm in the same boat. Yeah.
You know, I would love to get a job. I would love to have benefits. My husband is, you know, getting near retirement age. We've been talking about it. We need to keep insurance.
Mm-hmm.
So I would love to find a job where we could have a decent insurance package, and my husband could retire because, you know, he's getting up there. He wants to. We can't do it.
I hear you. I understand. And again, look, I've talked about this a lot. You know, David is self-employed. I actually work for him. One of my jobs is managing his you know, his website, doing all his, you know, online stuff, doing all that. So I am on his, you know, as an employee, on his insurance. But we pay, with two of us, $2,400 a month for health insurance, and we each have a $2,000 annual deductible before our insurance kicks in and pays anything. I mean, it's no bargain.
And it actually would be higher for my husband and I, because I am a cancer survivor. My husband was in a near fatal accident, auto accident, and still has, you know, lingering issues because of that.
Right.
We are essentially uninsurable for us to get a private insurance.
Right. Well, and as our, I mean, we both have pre-existing conditions too. Look, I'm a cancer survivor. I had malignant melanoma. It's that's why it's so high. And so and again, we're still waiting and waiting and waiting for Obamacare to give us that. In order to get in on the pre-existing condition pool, you have to go without insurance for 6 months. Well, you know what? We can't do that. Because you do that and something happens, and then, you know, forget it. Then you know, all bets are off. I mean, we know what's happened to people who've gotten a catastrophic illness while they're uninsured. It's just, guess what? We're a little too responsible for that.
Right. But, I mean, it's disgusting and repellent to me to hear these right-wingers who are projecting their own laziness.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, let's be honest. The thing about right-wing talking points is whatever they're saying about that they're attributing to others is stuff that they actually feel. These are lazy people.
Right.
These are people who would rather not work and get money. And frankly, if you look at Tucker Carlson's career, I'd say he's done a pretty good job of that for the most of his adult life.
Mm-hmm.
And so they project those things onto people who aren't like that. I know lots of people who would love to get a job. We see it on our comments at Chris Myers all the time. People with college degrees who can't even get a job working retail because there's so much out, there's so much competition out there, and employers are going to drive wages down. They're going to take away as many benefits as possible, make it as, so that just the smallest, most desperate minority will take the job.
Yes, I hear you. Now, Nicole Belle, there's one more thing. David has been, this is a request that I ask about this, because honestly, I don't have a problem with it. He does. And I guess the right-wingers are all up in arms over the fact, and I didn't see this. I only heard about it when David asked me about it. Apparently on Friday, Crystal Ball, who was one of the hosts on The Cycle, which I don't ever watch because I can't stand the sight of SE Cup, Crystal Ball introduced it's an online-only feature called Political Playground, in which she said she focused on marriage equality issues. In the feature, Crystal Ball asked her young daughter to reveal what she understands about marriage and asked if she would, quote, marry a girl when she gets older. So I guess the right-wingers are going nuts that Crystal Ball brought her 5-year-old kid on the air to talk about marriage equality.
Okay.
Your take on that?
I honestly don't have a problem with it. I mean, I've had these conversations with my kids,
so
too. My kid's like, what's the big deal, Mom?
Right, as is my kid. And I think I haven't watched the segment. I have no idea how it went. But I think what the point, I guess, she was trying to make is, for kids, it's not an issue. I got to say, look, I admit it. I watch soap operas. I don't watch a lot of soap operas. I used to watch One Life to Live. Susie Madrick is with me on this. Susie Madrick and I were both heartbroken when One Life to Live was canceled. We're happy now because it's apparently being resuscitated online. So that's a good thing. But in its wake, and then I when I was a kid, I watched General Hospital, and I started watching it again because there was no more, One Life to Live. And so it's now celebrating its 50th anniversary, so I was sort of watching the marathon all weekend as they went back through the years. It was kind of fascinating because I watched it when I was a kid. All right, but the point I'm making is there's a gay character on the show now, and there's a young girl, a little girl who's got to be 5 or 6, and the cutest thing, she was like explaining to her father that, I forget, Felix. Well, Felix likes Milo, but Milo, likes the Sabrina. But Felix likes boys, and Milo likes girls. And, as a little kid, and it's not a big deal to them. And maybe that's the point she was trying to make with the little kid. Because I thought that scene with the little kid was like, that's how kids are. They don't care.
Right. Well, there was a similar scene on the show Modern Family, which has a gay couple
with an
adopted child.
Right, and the little girl.
And,
go ahead. The little
Vietnamese girl.
Right.
Right. And she went out for an outing with her, step-grandmother.
Right. Oh, right.
The relationships
get weird.
And she announced that she was gay.
Right.
And that just freaked out that freaked out Gloria. And it came out after a while that she thought she was gay because she heard one of her classmates say that he was Italian because his father was from Italy. And so she said, well, then I must be gay because my fathers are gay.
Right.
And, I think that for most of that younger generation, they've grown up with family, with, friends who are open.
Right, and they have, friends with two moms or two dads, and it's just not an issue. You know why? They haven't been taught that there's anything wrong with it.
Right, and you have to be taught to hate.
Exactly.
And that's what it comes down to. My daughter has a friend who has two moms. I have a gay uncle. They're just part of our lives.
Right.
It's not that big a deal.
Exactly.
And I think that's why this gay marriage issue has been able to turn around so amazingly quickly. I can't think of another civil rights issue where you have gotten the majority of the population to catch up with progressives this fast.
Right, exactly.
And I think it has to do with that gay people made choices in the 70s and 80s of saying, you know what, I'm going to be out, I'm going to be proud, and I'm going to show that I am just like everybody else.
You're right, and it all goes back to Harvey Milk, and I heard, I guess it was his birthday recently or something, and I heard some quotes from him, and one was he told people, you want to change the attitudes about us, then you need to come out of the closet. You cannot stay in the closet and expect people to accept us. You've got to come out and be open and be who you are.
Right, and you know, you've got people as divergent as Marie Osmond, who comes from a very conservative Mormon family, but she has a gay daughter who said, I support gay marriage.
Yep.
You know, you've got that. You've got Magic Johnson, who came out this weekend and said that he supports his gay son.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's people are now acknowledging this is just part of life. And
that's
these
it.
Are human beings, and they deserve human dignity.
Absolutely.
Now, if we could just get that about women and equality, I'd be so much happier.
No kidding. Yeah, well, we'll take that up another day. Nicole Belle of Crooks and Liars for our weekly Fools on the Hill segment.
Psst. Yo quiero Nicole Belle.
Thank you, honey. We'll see you online back here next Monday. And with that, we are done for today. We'll do it again tomorrow with Richard Esko. More on the Obama's ridiculousness and Social Security and Medicare cuts and how we fight back. And, of course, got a laugh, too, from thepoliticalcarnival.net. All right. We will leave today with a send-off, one last send-off to Margaret Thatcher. Here we go. All right. Bye, Maggie. Rest in peace. See you tomorrow.
I ain't gonna work on